Poštovani gledači, dobrodošli u uštedno izdanje na Moabiti So. Danas Moabiti me so Sam Vaknin, čovjek od Izrael i makedonski zet. Žive v Makedonija so nekoj periodi koga bil nadvor od 1996. godina i odlično je poznava i makedonskata ekonomija i makedonskata politika i to je go vidim i sega. Dobrodošli, gospodine Vaknin.
Thank you for having me.
Кажете ни, без јас да ве представам, кој е Сам Вакнин? Што сте правиле до сега? Кога сте роден? Кај сте живееле? Што сте студирале?
I'm almost 50 years old. I've written dozens of books. I studied in the United States and in Israel. I'm right now an analyst and commentator, mainly in American media. Prior to that, I was economic advisor to a few governments, including the government of Macedonia. I even co-authored a book with Nikola Gruevski, believe it or not. And my main concentration in the last few years is on my work in the field of mental health. I have written a series of books on personality disorders. I've participated in several documentaries. I make myself available as a subject to be studied by mental health practitioners and professionals all over the world, and so on. So this is becoming my main concentration. But still, I make a living by covering the Balkans, Eastern Europe, and Central Europe for the Chronicle Media Group in the United States, which is now has become, I think, the second largest newspaper group in the United States. And online, I'm the associate editor of a pretty well-frequented website for political affairs called Global Politician. So that's it in a nutshell.
Така. Ќе оставиме вашите експертиза за ментално здравје, тоа помалку не интересира.
This is the most relevant for Macedonia.
Ама тоа дека биде тема за друг пат. Ќе оставиме сега главно што најмногу не интересира е политиката и економијата. Кои се вашите искуства со економијата, вашето образование во економијата?
I have no education in economics, but since I was 19 or 20, I have been in senior positions in many big firms, mainly privately held Jewish firms in the world. I've been advisor to six governments, economic advisor to six governments, and I've been economic and financial advisor to 50 or 60 of the biggest firms in the world, including all of the big firms in Israel. So in 30 years of experience with economics and business, I accumulated some knowledge. I, of course, read a lot. I have written well over 2,000 articles. My work has been quoted more than 50 times in the Journal of Finance, which is the most respectable journal of economics in the world. So I feel comfortable to say that I'm an economist, although again I don't have an academic degree.
Да. Тоа сакав да ве прашам за да видиме кој е вашиот кредибилитет во економијата. Значи сепак имате големи познавања, така да оно што ќе не го кажете не биде од човек лаик, туку човек што има големо искуство во тоа. А пред да продолжиме со тоа, во разговорот пред неколку дена ми кажавте дека денес во Македонија не ве сака ни позицијата, ни позицијата. Зошто мислите дека така, дека им зборувате работи кои не им се допаѓаат или што е причината?
Because you don't have a real position, coalition or opposition. You have a group of thieves in a kleptocracy. These thieves are your politicians. Some of them, it is a theater. And in this theater, some of them are acting the opposition, some of them are acting the coalition. They change roles from time to time. Each one of them must have the time to steal, so they do it via elections. And they are very unhappy when there is a truly independent, especially foreigner, who is not afraid and cannot be intimidated, cannot be blackmailed, and what is absolutely unacceptable to them cannot be bought, cannot be corrupted. This for them is a completely new phenomenon, and a very frightening phenomenon, because they are used to buy, and if they cannot buy someone, to frighten that someone, and if they cannot frighten that someone, to throw him, you know, to do even worse things. And none of it, they've tried everything with me. They've tried to buy me, they've tried to corrupt me, they've tried to frighten me, they've tried absolutely everything. And nothing is working. It's not working. I keep saying what I think. I am not saying that what I think is the truth. necessarily. I'm not saying that I know best. I'm not saying that what I say is the only correct thing. But I'm definitely dealing with my opinions, the way I see the truth. It's a very personal perspective and aspect. But I am consistent in being loyal only to what I regard to be the truth and being loyal only to myself. I have no other loyalty. I worked with Gruevski. Some people say that I invented Gruevski and built him and created him in effect. So I worked with him, and when he strayed off the right path, and when he, in my view, violated some serious ethical codes of conduct and so on, I was not afraid to criticize him. Among my friends are people like Fershkovsky and people like Gruevski. I don't, among my enemies are people from left and right. That is a good sign. When you have enemies on the left and on the right, you must be doing something right.
Ова што го кажавте за политичари како луѓе кои крадат, всушност го потврди бившиот премиер Лјупче Георгиевски, кој кажа на телевизија дека кога човек дојде на власт, тогаш мора нешто да краде.
You don't have politicians in Macedonia. You don't have actually any type of professionals in Macedonia. In Macedonia, Macedonia it is the rule of amateurism. That is the reason you look like you look. Not good. Everything is ruled by amateurs. Everyone is an amateur. People who are today construction workers used to be taxi drivers. Taxi drivers used to be doctors. Doctors used to be politicians. Politicians used to be I don't know what. No one has a profession. No one learns anything in depth. No one invests in his own skills and education, ongoing education. It's all complete improvisation and patchwork. This could have worked during the Ottoman Empire. But you are living in the 21st century, and if you don't get your act together, you will not have an act.
А како објаснувате, значи сепак има македонци кои се многу образовани експерти кои аве заминале во странство, може и таму или баш заради тоа заминале во странство, бидејќи тука не можеле да.
The Macedonian state is a negative filter. It's a negative. It encourages negative selection. In other words, if you are talented, if you are skilled, if you are educated, your aim is to leave Macedonia. You get educated, you get skilled and so on in order to leave Macedonia. There have been celebrations in the street with a visa liberalization. Why? Because people could travel to see Paris. They could have done it before. But because it would be much easier to emigrate, to leave this hell, you know. People want to leave this place. If the gates were truly open and everyone was given 100,000 euros as a gift, in Macedonia, I think there would have been left 3 people, maybe. The problem is that the educated, the skilled, and so on leave, and those who do remain here keep their distance from politics, keep their distance from management. They keep a distance. They don't want to be involved in public affairs.
Добро, тоа е веројатно и многу точно. Гледам и тоа дека интелектуалната класа во Македонија, ако и постои, не се меша многу во политиката и тоа му го остава на други кои тоа го прават. Едно друго прашање кое се надоврзува на овие преходните. Гледаме дека економиите на нашите соседи одат напред. Да не зборувам за Албанија, која навистина од многу назадна земја е лидер на Балканот и меѓу светот, меѓу странски инвестиции. Да, и тоа ќе рече ви второ. И Косово оди многу напред. Сите одат напред, ние изгледа како да седиме на место или како што каже на мој пријател, тониме на место. Зошто мислите дека тоа е така? Дали се политичарите криви и кој е крив?
Yes, of course your elite or lack of elite, the fact that you don't have an elite, or the fact that all your elite is composed of extremely low level тешки селјаци. Yes, and I'm talking about professors, so-called professors. I'm talking about so-called politicians. So talking about so-called doctors, everything here, this is a така наречена земја. Everything here is make-belief. Everything is facade, you know. So, of course, your lack of elite is a serious problem, and I would say the most serious problem. But this is only one problem. You have, of course, I don't want to neglect the objective problems. You have objective problems. You're a very small country, your internal market is small, and doesn't allow for expansion and development. You have very, very evil neighbors who made your life hell since you became independent and are now blocking your economic and political development and accession to NATO and EU. So all these are objective problems. We should not ignore, of course, objective problems. But there are also, unfortunately, subjective problems. And if I have to allocate blame, I would say that your objective problems account for 30% of your retarded state as economically, and your subjective problems account for 70%. I would also say that there is very little you can do regarding your objective problems, but there is a lot you can do regarding your subjective problems. Yet you allocate your resources exactly opposite. You put most of your resources on objective problems where you have very little influence, and you put no resources at all, or very little resources, in your subjective problems. And your subjective problems can be summarized in one word, and that is mentality. So, for instance, there is a sense of entitlement. Everyone feels entitled, you know. Everyone wants to take 100 from the public purse, from the collective, and give the collective, if possible, zero, if possible. Since it is not possible, then 5 or 10. But definitely not to take 100 and give 110, or take 100 and give 90, God forbid. Everyone invests enormous amounts of energy and resources and thinking and expertise to avoid his share in the collective purse. And this leads to the next issue. And the next issue is that you do not have a mentality of a collective. You have a mentality of family. You have a mentality of Nasselba, settlement. You have a mentality of tribe. You have a lot of conflict, a lot of mentalities that are conflicting with the mentality of a nation state. You do not function as a nation. You keep claiming that you're a nation, but I see no sign of it.
Pa dobro, istiot problem može to je i balkanski. Evo, Grcija, na primjer, кажува дека не може да ги соберат таксите на 30% од населението. Дури имаше напис во Економист кој вели ако држава нема можност да собира 30% од таксите, тогаш може нема и суверенитет на својата територија. Така да може тоа е балкански менталитет.
This is one aspect. The discourse in Greece is a Greek discourse. It's a discourse of the collective called Greece. The discourse in Albania, the narrative, is a narrative or a discourse of Albanians in a collective called Albania. The discourse in Macedonia is only lately a Macedonian discourse, and even that is limited to the name issue. In all other respects, there is no Macedonian narrative or discourse. What do you have in common as far as the Macedonian narrative with someone from SDSM? Very little. You have no, it's not only a question of common history or interpretation of common histories, it's a question of deciding that there is something bigger than yourself, something for which you are willing to make sacrifices, something to which you want to contribute at least as much as you take from. You don't have this here. I think this is a result of 5 centuries of Ottoman rule, where the state was the enemy. The state was simply the enemy. 5 centuries, you regarded the state as your enemy. And even in Yugoslavia, there was this perception, you know, that, okay, let's try to avoid paying taxes, let's try to avoid the NAI. You know, there was this perception that the collective is the enemy of the individual. And in this sense, by the way, Macedonia is a highly individualistic society. It's a paradox that Macedonia is a highly individualistic society, and it is fit for entrepreneurship and so on. If it was given the right conditions, people here could have made a lot of business and a lot of, and so on, and but they are not given the right conditions. So you're not benefiting from the collective spirit, like in Japan. You're not benefiting from collective, and you are not allowing the individual to express himself or herself economically because of the elites, the rapacious, ravenous, corrupt, thieving elites. You lost both worlds.
Ali to može da go povrzim i su iskustvena na diasporata koja еве има општо познато мислење дека ако во Македонија не може да се инвестира бидејќи некој ќе ти укради парите дали или државата не може да те заштити правно и сето тоа, тоа е веројатно и поврзано со тоа.
Macedonia's only hope is the diaspora. Only hope. Macedonia is a hopeless case. It's a basket case. Its only hope is the diaspora. And in second place, maybe foreign investors. Foreign investors can influence a bit management practices, exports, some economic perspectives. But foreign investors are here and there. They are, and they're not committed, as I said, they're not committed to a collective. They are committed to their own profits. And if this means robbing the state, denuding the state, destroying the state even, they will do it. They destroyed states. They destroyed Hawaii. They destroyed Panama. It's not a problem. So foreign investors are not the real bedrock. The whole strategy of the government building the future of Macedonia on foreign investment is, first of all, a failure. Secondly, wrong. The government, this government and any previous and future government, should build its policy on what the Jews did in Israel. The Jews built the state of Israel on the diaspora, and only on the diaspora. We trust no one. We trust no American president. We trust no foreign investors. We trust no one and nobody. We don't even trust ourselves. We Israelis trust only the diaspora. We know that these 10, 8 million Jews will come to our help at any given time. They give us $1 billion a year in bonds. They buy bonds, Israeli bonds. They invest in manufacturing facilities and in our economy. They give us a lot of knowledge and management skills. They give us support, political lobbying and other types of lobbying in where it counts, which is the United States. We don't pay much attention to Europe, but where it counts, we are fully represented and even to some extent in control. Macedonia has a diaspora of 2 to 3 million people, which on in some parts of the world, for instance, Canada, is educated and represented in the free professions and so on and so forth. Macedonia, for instance, did not use diaspora skills and capacities for the name issue. There are some outstanding Macedonian international lawyers who offered their services free of charge and were rejected. Macedonia rejected diaspora help on the name issue, on the Albanian insurgency, on economics, not to mention. The few diaspora figures who were allowed to interfere for schminka, for makeup, for public relations, not for real, when they started to do a serious job, they were expelled, simply expelled. And I'm talking about Gligo Tashkovic, yes? So there is no real commitment to the diaspora. Why? You can ask why. It's insane. Why not? I mean, here's a group of people. They send every year $1.1 billion to Macedonia.
Euros,
I'm sorry, to Macedonia. 1.1 billion euros to Macedonia. And why not allow them to contribute also, management skills, contacts. They have contacts, you name it. They can lift Macedonia as the Albanians are doing in Kosovo. Same. Why not? Simply. Because here, the political elite, the thieves that call themselves political elite, are afraid of competition. It's as simple as that. These people who come from diaspora are more educated. The garbage that is in the political parties is garbage. It's not educated. These people are skilled. These people are failures. The local politicians are failures. They failed in everything. They failed in business. They failed in marriage. They failed in absolutely everything. And the only thing left to them is politics. Politics here is a negative filter. It's like a strain in the sink where all the garbage remain stuck. Garbage doesn't like competition. And as long as you have this kind of subpar, I don't know how to describe them, elites, they will not allow the diaspora to come here because they are afraid of the diaspora.
To može bi je i zašto mnogo mediji ja napadna je makedonska diaspora neka ne pomaga, ne doprinesuva da makedonska ekonomija. Вероятно е тоа причината што кажувате вие.
Well, like other countries, in the world, Macedonian media is owned by businessmen with their own interests, and because Macedonia has no economy, well over one third of the workforce is employed by the government, and the budget is 52% of GDP. So the economy is the government. So every businessman in Macedonia must coexist with the government or be destroyed. Be destroyed legally, illegally, it doesn't matter. Be destroyed. And because they have to live with the government, coexist with the government, they force the media, they use the media either to accommodate the government or to attack the government in order for the government to bribe them to and so on. So the media here is not real in any sense. the recent diaspora initiatives, not only your initiative, but other initiatives, there were other initiatives not connected to yours and not even on political issues, but economic issues. All recent diaspora initiatives were completely suppressed by all the rainbow of Macedonian media, left, right, and center. That is because, I repeat what I'm telling you, the diaspora threatens the local elites, the local political elite, the local business elite, and the local intellectual elite. These elites feel threatened. The local professors would not be allowed to clean the classrooms in the University of Toronto or in Tel Aviv. It's that bad. Your economist, one of your most prominent economists who became a minister of finance, does not know the difference between GNP and GDP. That's not a story, that is the truth. He asked the IMF delegation, what's the difference? That's the level of your intellectual. That's the level. And they are afraid of diaspora.
Ајде да видиме малку за прашањето на проблемот со името со Грција. Што мислите вие, дали Македонија треба да продолжи да преговара или разговара со Грција или што треба да направи?
Before I come to the answer, and again, of course, it's only my opinion. I have no monopoly on the truth. I'm not a divine entity as opposed to Nikola Gruevski, yes. But before we come to the I want to make six observations, which are very pertinent, and some of them are not made often. They are made, but not often. First of all, not every conflict can be resolved. There is an underlying assumption in the name issue that all, this is the American attitude, the what I call malignant optimism. The Americans believe that if you throw enough money at a problem, or if you throw enough time or resources, every problem in the world can be solved. Well, the truth is, it's not true. For instance, I believe that conflict between Israelis and Palestinians cannot be solved. Cannot be solved. And I also believe that the name issue cannot be solved. It's what we call an irresolvable conflict. That's point number one. Point number two, when you take an unreasonable demand, and a demand that is from the beginning unreasonable, never mind how much you modify it, it still remains unreasonable. No amount of modifications and recasting and rephrasing renders an unreasonable demand reasonable. So this relates to the Greek protestations that they've modified their position, they're becoming more flexible and so on, but you can't modify an unreasonable demand. Thirdly, never succumb to blackmail, because this is Israeli attitude. We never succumb to blackmail. We never negotiate with terrorists. We never do that. Not because of some ethical or moral, you know, superiority, but because blackmail never ends. You've been blackmailed once about the flag. You thought it was the end. You changed your constitution. You thought it was the end. It's not the end. Now you're being blackmailed about the name. You will reach an agreement. People will approve it in the referendum. You maybe will change your constitution. Do you think it's the end? It's not the end. There is no end to blackmail unless you put an end to it. The third observation is, Macedonia is a small country with extremely scarce resources, especially human resources. The name issue takes from you resources. It takes from you human resources, takes from you money, takes from you attention, takes from you, you know. It depletes you. It makes you tired. You don't have the necessary, I know it from the Prime Minister, I know the Prime Minister personally. I know this is the case in his case. He simply is tired. He has no time to think of economy, of development, of, you know. So you're paying a huge price. You think you're not paying a price. So what if we negotiate? No, it's not true. You're paying a huge price. Fourth observation is, because Macedonia is so obscure and not covered by the global media and so on, you have allowed fourth-rate diplomats and sixth-rate economists to tell you what to do. And this is a serious mistake. This is a serious mistake because these people are nothing in Brussels. They are less than nothing in Washington. They are nothings. They are nobodies. And you allow these nobodies to dictate your life, your future, not to mention your identity. And finally, sixth observation is, you are winning the battle with Greece. I never saw a compromise out of position of winning. When you win, you don't compromise, you dictate. you have succeeded to convince 127 countries to recognize you in the constitutional name. You're winning. You're absolutely winning. The sympathy of the world, from the economists to you name it, everyone in New York Times, all the global media is against Greece and with you on this issue. The European Union is writhing, and European Commission is, I don't know, they're all trying to find some, let them. I mean, it's not your problem. It's the problem of Greece. Let Greece solve it with whoever they want to solve it. Having said all that, I think it would be mistaken to unilaterally pull out of the negotiations, because then Greece will be able to blame you for the collapse of this futile effort. It's a futile effort. But what I would do, I would play the game. I would stick to my guns and to my positions. I would send extremely low-level representatives on vacations to Washington and so on to talk to the extremely low-level Greeks that appear there. And I would continue this game another 25 years if they want, or 50. Withdrawing unilaterally is an act that will draw the fire towards Macedonia, direct the fire at Macedonia unjustly. Play the game, you know? Just don't be so involved in it. Don't predicate it as the cornerstone of your existence. It's not. It's a totally, in my view, fringe and marginal issue that has been expanded and inflated by interested politicians.
Много интересно гледаште, се сложувам апсолутно со вас. Нашата причина за отпочнување на кампањата беше со тоа дека ние мислиме со преговори, кога преговараме за нешто, даваме грешен сигнал на другата страна дека ние ќе направиме компромис, и затоа Америка и Европа нас не притискаат. За тоа беше причината и мислам, добро, и вашето мислење е многу интересно. Што мислите би се случило со етничките односи во Македонија ако прашањето за името се одложило и понатаму?
Nothing will happen. The Albanians in Macedonia are as interested in stealing money from the state as the Macedonians are. This is the hobby of 99% of the population here. Everyone is into the crime of robbing the state, including the Albanians. The Albanian sector is involved in the informal economy, and that is a gentle way of saying that they derive a lot of their livelihood from criminal activities. Acceding to the EU, becoming an EU member, will put a stop to these criminal activities and to the informal economy. Do you think the Albanians are crazy? They want to join the EU so that all their economic enterprises, which are giant economic enterprises, all these economic enterprises will stop. They are delighted to have Gruevski in power. They are extremely happy the name issue is not succeeding. They bless God in a mosque or I don't know where, day, night, and evening for not acceding to NATO and not acceding to the EU. It leaves the territory open for smuggling, prostitution, and other typically Albanian activities. So they have a vested interest in the failure of Macedonia's accession, not in its success.
No interest, no?
Of course, just one thing. Mm-hmm. Of course, they will never say that. What they will do is they will use the failure in collaboration with the international community to blackmail the Macedonians to give them more concessions on the state level. Mm-hmm. That is perfectly understandable. But it's important to also understand that the international community will not support a resumption of 2001. The international community is committed to the Ohrid Agreement. So the Albanians are not part of this equation at all, should not be, are not, and should be ignored. Whatever noises they make, they should be ignored.
А што да им речеме на тие што велат дека Македонија, ако не влезе веднаш во НАТО, Европска Унија ќе пропадне? Или со други зборови, што мислите вие, дали за Македонија е добро да влезе во Европска Унија и во НАТО?
Of course, in the long term, it would be very wise to enter the European Union because it's a big market. But have a look at what's happening now. Macedonia has all the benefits of the EU without the costs of the EU. Macedonia has a completely free trade agreement with the EU. Macedonia has a completely free trade agreement with CEFTA. Macedonia has visa-free travel. What else are you going to get from the EU? You are getting free trade. You are getting visa-free travel. You are getting regional funds, by the way. Macedonia just rejected some of them and don't know what to do with it. What else are you going to get from the EU when you accede? Nothing. You are getting everything right now. The only thing is you are not paying the costs of acceding to the EU, because when you accede to the EU, there are tremendous costs. Your local manufacturing sector is open to competition. You have to implement 84,000 pages of legislation. You have to instill, you have to put in place environmental protections, which in my view will destroy half your industry within overnight, and hygienic and sanitation demands and so on. So there are huge costs associated, which will make you much less competitive than you are right now, and will not give you anything in return because you already have everything. You understand?
No, absolutely.
Only effect of EU accession in the very long term, mind you, not immediate, is FDI. Foreign investors will look at Macedonia and will say, okay, now they're members of the EU. Let's see. Let's see what's happening and maybe we'll invest. So you can ask me, okay, so why 60 or 86% of people are want to join the EU? Well, the reason is very simple and it goes back to my first answer. Because you don't have collective awareness. You have only individual, your own individual interests are more important to you than the interests of the nation and the state. When Macedonia joins the EU, the prices of apartments will go up. The stock prices will go up. The speculators in this country, which is essentially all the population, will make profits. Entering the EU will make individual profits. It will make damage on the state level, but profits to individuals. That's why you want to join the EU. There's absolutely no other reason, in my view.
Много интересно. За последно прашање ќе ве прашам по некој случај станавте премиер на Македонија. Што би направили во првите?
Ке дадам оставка. Одмах ке дадам оставка.
И тоа е добро.
I repeat my open this country to diaspora and the competition that the diaspora brings. Allow the diaspora to vote, integrate the diaspora in decision making, make members of the elite in the diaspora members of the local elite, and open this country exactly as Kosovo and Albania have done. They have done well with this strategy. And of course, the ultimate example is Israel. Israel is a giant, economic giant. Do you know what is Israel? It's smaller than Macedonia. It's 60% desert. There's nothing there. It's a horrible place, infested with mosquitoes, and it's simply horrible. But it became one of the economic giants of the world, only because of the Jews. By the way, same with Hong Kong and so on, the Chinese diaspora. Diaspora, that's the key today. This is your network to the world, you know. You are not using the highway. You're not, it's amazing, this is your main asset, and you're not using it.
Точно, се сложам со вас. Сем, многу ви благодарам, ова беше многу интересен разговор. Се надам дека и вие, драги гледачи, се сложувате со тоа. Толку беше за денес, останете со нас.